a chance later on for each of you to have your say about what's concerning you. However, recent events in our country have made us, including the San Bernardino and most recently in Orlando. That the terrorists are among us. And so I've invited Special Agent Montoya from the Air Force Office of Special Investigation from the Edwards Detachment here to discuss their program Operation Eagle Eyes, which is an Air Force anti-terrorism initiative that enlists the eyes and ears of Air Force members and citizens in the war on terror. So, Jennifer, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Dennis.
How's everybody doing today?
Good.
All right, thank you so much for having me. This is my first one of these meetings that I've attended, and it's wonderful to see so many people turn out, so many wonderful members of the community. So I just want to say thank you for having me. So as Dennis mentioned, the Air Force Office of Special Investigations is like NCIS, pretty much. Does anybody know what NCIS is? Seen the show? Think of that, but for the Air Force. It's the same exact thing, like the FBI, like everybody else. So what we do is felony-level investigations with an Air Force nexus. So it has to have some sort of Air Force related matter, whether it's a military member or a DOD civilian that's an Air Force civilian, anything like that. That's what we investigate. And that's criminal investigations, that's your narcotics, sexual assault, that kind of stuff, counterintelligence investigations, and as Dennis mentioned, anti-terrorism. And that's why I'm here today, talk to you guys about anti-terrorism. So you turn on the news any day, anybody watch CNN, Fox News, all that good stuff, what do you see? Besides the elections, of course, what is the other number one topic? Right, ISIS, right? What happened in Orlando, what happened in San Bernardino not too long ago, which is literally right in our backyard in December. This is a huge problem, and this is something that is completely unprecedented. It's something that we couldn't have imagined in our worst dreams, that we really cannot plan for. It can happen at any minute now. And as Des mentioned, it's very generic to say the terrorists are among us, but it's absolutely true. Why? Because ISIS is inciting its citizens here, stateside, your neighbors, guys, to conduct what are called lone wolf attacks. So that's pretty much being radicalized online, reading this media. It's Islamic extremist sort of media, like, hey, you know, you need to do this, you need to do that. And it motivates people that live among us to conduct these attacks. And there's really no way that we can plan for it to say, or that we know when people are going to plan for it, that it's going to happen at such and such date. So that's why I'm here, to let you guys know that there's only so many of us in the detachment. There's maybe about 10 or 12 of us, but look at how many of you are here. You are an extension of us, and we are here to protect you, to serve the community, and we really cannot do our job without you guys. So that's what I'm here today for. I ask you guys, if you see something, say something. And you hear that all the time, right? But what does that mean exactly? It means pretty much anything, any suspicious activity that you see. And what I mean by suspicious activity is any anomaly. For those scientists, engineers out there, anybody in the crowd, any sort of thing that just kind of makes the hair in the back of your neck stand up, things that don't look right, a person that looks a little bit suspicious that shouldn't necessarily be there, don't ever think, well, somebody will say something. Somebody's going to take care of it. Oh, I just saw a patrol call over there. They'll take care of it. I mentioned, you heard something about the what? Closing?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's not good. We need those guys. We need the police. We work with them pretty much every day. We work with the FBI. We work with any agency you can possibly imagine. But again, we can only do so much. There's only so many police officers out there. That's why I need you guys. If you see something, tell anybody, really any authority, whether it's Kern County sheriffs, whether it's a PD person when you're down in LA, a security guard, just anybody that you see, guys. I'm going to leave my cards here with you, with Dennis, so you can grab one, and it has a number in there. You can text a hotline, or you can call security forces at the base directly, and then we'll get a hold of us as well. So that's pretty much all I have for you guys, but do you have any questions? I know that's a huge topic. That's a lot to cover, but any comments, any concerns?
Well, Jennifer, maybe you could give your telephone number and your email address verbally to everybody so they could write it down.
All right.
Yeah, John's with you.
Maybe you pass all the cards out, don't you?
That's right, exactly. Well, everything's right here, too.
Yeah. But some people won't get the card.
Yeah, that's true. Okay. First name Jennifer, dot last name Montoya, Montoya, at us.af.mil. And the phone number here is going to be 661-277-3340. And I have a bunch of them. There should be about maybe 100 or more cards right here.
That's not
exactly. Any
so,
questions?
So it's Jennifer Montoya at
Jennifer.Montoya.
Dot Montoya.
At us.
AF.
.af.mil. Everybody get that?
Go ahead, pass the card, maybe you
have... Jennifer...
I'll leave these up here.
.montoya, M-O-N-T-O-Y-A, at US dot AF dot M-I-L.
Questions, comments, or any...
661-277-3340. That's actually the police desk, but they'll route the call to her.
They'll let us know.
But the point is, look how many sets of eyes we have here in the room. All of us need to be watching out all the time for suspicious behavior, persons out of place, that kind of thing. You wonder, why are they acting that way? Things just aren't quite right. If you see something, say something. That's what she said. You know, and it's a very short presentation, but it's very powerful. Because we're so close to the base, I don't think we're that far off from being a target, quite frankly.
No.
So we need to have our wits about us. Okay? That's the reason I asked her here. With all that's going on, we've got to help ourselves. That's what it comes down to. Yes, sir?
Response time. Somebody makes that phone call. What happens?
Well, it depends on what's said, sir. It really depends if it's like, you know, I see somebody doing X, Y, and Z. It just really depends on what we're going to do. We're right here. We're how many minutes from the gate? 20, maybe?
20 or something? 20. A lot can happen in 20 minutes.
Absolutely, yes, sir.
So,
but the
so
great thing is
that...
So are
supposed to be calling the Sheriff's Department here? Is that a common response? We get a hold of you guys? What is the process?
Definitely the number one thing, if you see something that's going to cause some sort of imminent danger to somebody, call the police, call 911. That's number one thing. Suspicious sort of activity thing, we can file like a suspicious activity report, you can call us too. But definitely call the locals first and foremost. We coordinate with them constantly. We have a very good working relationship with them. So if they feel like it's something that's pertinent to us, something that concerns us, that has to do with the base or maybe a little bit higher up, like more terrorist related, then they'll let us know.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So if the sheriff department's still here, we're still able to call them. If they're not here anymore, what is the response time for the next sheriff to get here?
20 minutes.
Can't answer that, sir. Yeah.
So everything is
around making observations, following people, coming in and out of the gate. I mean, there's only one road in and out to the base, which is right here, from through here in this area. Of course, there's a south and north gate, but I'm talking about specifically the north and stuff like that. Any other questions, sir?
Can you tell us some more of the key characteristics that are being seen that you guys are, you know, being told about that we could look for? You know, like in my job, people doing espionage, you know, they don't like
right.
to go on vacation, they like to work alone. What is the terrorist seeing? What is there?
It's such a large variety. Like I said, we really can't pinpoint specifically what it is. It's not in the business of targeting a specific group or anything like that. It's just things like that, like observing, watching, if you ever feel like you're being followed, coming in and out of the gate, that kind of stuff, really. If you work with somebody and they start making specific comments or they have a lot of foreign travel to specific places, that's also an indication as well. Just like what you saw with a lot of online activity, if you ever see them... browsing a specific website that kind of catches your attention at work or anything like that. We rely a lot on local businesses too to look out for this kind of stuff. Like you mentioned, the chemicals or anything like that. If you run a hardware store, that kind of stuff, we like to see if anybody's buying sort of a lot of quantities of a specific material, or even if somebody works at a place where they sell firearms and you come across something suspicious. That's definitely what happened in Orlando. You try to purchase weapons beforehand, and that was notified to the FBI as well. There's still ongoing investigation and more information to be determined from that, but that was definitely something that we saw. And they've been seeing that in past instances as well. Saw that in San Bernardino, the same thing. Does that kind of answer your question?
You want to get those?
Yeah, but they're changing generally.
Okay, next up on the agenda are community leader reports. And we'll start with the Kern County Supervisor Representative. Ryan, what have you got for us tonight? Please stay and say your name.
Yeah, I'm Ryan. Nice to meet you guys. I work for Zach Scrivener, County Supervisor. I'm his field rep. And I think I know we have a lot bigger crowd than we usually have, so I think I know what most people are here for. So I'd like to divert my speaking time to public comments since I'm sure we're going to be hearing from the public a lot, and can address concerns there. I think that'd probably be better.
What you tell you, us at the table here, what's been going on in the county the last week?
The big thing that everyone has been talking about the most is the budget. The Board of Supervisors adopted a preliminary budget. In that budget, a lot of the departments received less money than they have in past years. The most noted for the Rosamond area is Donny Youngblood, the sheriff, has reported that in order to balance his budget, he may have to close the Rosamond substation for the sheriff's office. That's something that will be in discussion from now all the way through until the final budget is decided in August. Supervisor Scrivener is meeting continually with Sheriff Youngblood to see what we can do to prevent that from happening. But the way it works is he's allocated a certain amount of money for his budget for the year, and he's not receiving as much money as usual due to the county budget. The price of oil is just continually dropping, which is our number one revenue source. And once he receives his budget, it is his responsibility and his his job to make that budget, to balance that budget, and to allocate the funds where he thinks is the most important places to allocate it. And so a big part for us is to try to help him to keep this substation open. It is our district. Rosamond is a large community with a large population, and Supervisor Scrivener will be meeting with Donny Youngblood regularly from now until August to see what can be done to alter his budget that he's presented.
Differently allocated.
Right. What's the number two revenue source, right?
What's the number two revenue source?
Number one is oil in the county. It's about around $40 billion a year. So just to put into perspective, our number two source now is renewable energy, and that's all the way down at like $6 or $7 billion a year. So oil is that big. It's bigger than almost our next 10 revenue sources combined.
Did the supervisor propose raises here?
Can we get public comments so that
we
we get public comments?
All right, let's move along here. Do we have anybody from Kern County Fire? Nope. Anybody here from the Sheriff's Office? You're popular tonight. And supported.
We love you, Jim.
Normally I just come up here and give you stats for the month, so we'll start with that. For the stats for May, we have 939 calls for service, 62 arrests. Of those calls, 6 were vandalism, 10 are stolen vehicles, 22 are thefts, drug offenses 14, and assaults 14. I do want to read something quickly from our commander. Lieutenant was going to be here tonight, but there's a fire in Kern Valley right now where a lot of resources are being tied up. So this is from our commander, Sean Beasley. As substation division commander, I assure you I do not want to close the Rosamond substation. We are doing all we can with a very challenging budget. There is no final decision made to close the Rosamond substation at this time. If it gets to that point, we will all the notice we can, and we will do all we can to provide the best law enforcement services to the area from the Mojave substation. Someone would not just be at the Mojave substation waiting for a call and responding to a resident. They would be assigned to and remain in the resident area. Deputies can do most everything they need to do administratively from the patrol cars. They already have to go to Mojave or Bakersfield at times to book prisoners. I hope this alleviates some of your concerns.
If the substation closes, and we feel we have no protection, very little protection, will Kern County issue to any qualified Rosamond citizens to pass a background check concealed carry permit?
Concealed weapon permits are right now on a shall issue basis.
Shall issue or may issue?
problem with the record.
Thank you.
If it was the Mojave substation, we'd just go.
Well, because the Mojave substation is attached to the Mojave jail and the courthouse, I'm assuming that whatever is paid would have to be paid anyway. So that building is not costing the Sheriff Department any extra funds at this point.
Take into consideration, too, folks, Mojave's not that far away. Like, if you really get an cop has a problem, flash the lights on and go 90 down the freeway and it's here in a second, and let's get real. If it's a real emergency, I think some of us are kind of getting out of hand with this, with the closing of the substation. I mean, yeah, it's not going to be nice if it happens. It'd be great if it stayed open, but Mojave, if it's what they have to do, it's not going to be permanent, or it shouldn't be.
Well, I've got a disagree with it. It's allocations. We got money to keep a pool open. We got a library. I'll tell you what, if you need a police station, you can have the other two.
Which leads to the question, what is the dollar amount that we need to keep it open? What is the budget drop from? Do we know that yet?
That's well above my pay grade.
Well, then let's be realistic. If this substation closes, we will lose sheriffs. They are not going to maintain the same amount of cars, the same amount of sheriffs, and close a building, because the building is not the funding problem. The problem is the amount of sheriffs, because wages far outweigh the cost of maintaining a building. We will lose sheriffs. And that's what we don't want to do, because we are too close to the base. We have too much traffic through here, and if terrorism does hit, Edwards is in the top 10 in the United States for a possible terrorist attack.
How many sheriffs are we down now?
And I did the theory that this substation down here costs us, the county a lot of money, rent wise. Yeah, a whole bunch, something like $100,000 a year or something. About $100,000 a year for that building.
Do you know what the rent or lease is on the building out here?
No,
That's something that Jen needs more than
You said we'll still have.
All right, let's go back to order. Yes, ma'am?
There is an option. There is something everyone in this room can do if you can pass a background check. You can become a volunteer for the Sheriff's Department. You can be eyes and ears for the deputies. You can drive a car and fly the flag, make a presence known in your community. Everybody can join if you can pass that background check and you are drug free.
Okay, let's come back to the agenda, please. And thank you for answering that. And thanks, Jim, for that report. Do we have anybody here from California Highway Patrol? Rosamond Community Watch. Nobody?
Jack's here. I'm no longer on the board.
Okay. Rosamond Community Services District.
Our president's here.
That was going to raise the rates that failed. The director voted that down. And there was two directors appointed to look at the budget. And they're going to cut everywhere they can possibly cut. And they're going to bring the recommendations back to the board when they do that. So we're looking out for you.
Yeah, when we found out that the your public meeting was going to be on our normal meeting, that we moved it so that we'd have good public participation for your meeting.
You did. Standing outside.
Good.
They got how many votes against the protest?
481. 78, 418, something like that.
And they had to have 25. To fail, but the director voted 3-2.
Okay. Well, that's good news. Thank you. Rosamond Foundation. Rosamond Chamber.
Go ahead and speak. Just
go ahead.
A comment this Saturday morning, 9 a.m. We're having the groundbreaking ceremony for the proposed Rosamond Event Center that we're building next to the chamber. Zach Scribner and Tom Lackey is to attend. And,
what time?
9 a.m.
9 a.m.?
Yeah. And be between the car wash and the chamber on that lot. And we'll have music and some refreshments. That's all I have.
Okay. So that's a groundbreaking. For this event center, you know, the point is the chamber is working hard to make Rosamond a better place to live and work, and that's the next step. So 9 o'clock Saturday morning, the note that I got from Terry said the idea was started back in October of 2013, and they're now ready to build. It takes a while to do that. So I would encourage you, as many of you as possible, to come out and support the chamber. If you haven't joined, it's a good organization to get behind and to have a chance to meet a couple of elected officials in the process. Okay, thank you for that report on the chamber. Rosamond Youth Football and Cheer.
Good evening, everybody. Those of you who don't know me, my name is Mike Garrett. I'm the president of Rosamond Youth Football and Cheer. Our season starts officially July 25th is our first practice. Still plenty of time to sign up. We'll be signing up. We have a 4th of July booth out here on Rosamond Boulevard at the Pumpkin Patch this year. We'll be signing up there, and we hope you come out and support us. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. Southern Kern Unified School District. Anybody here that can talk about that?
I attended the meeting, and there were three items. The first item was an honor given to Jill Fuller for her many years of service to the district. She's retiring to spend more time with the family. The dirt being moved from Tropico Middle School to Rosamond Elementary is just about all moved. 21,000 cubic feet to level up the pad for the new elementary school. The free breakfast and lunch program are serving about 150 meals during the day, and they expected more, but part of the reason is transporting kids from the west side over to Rosamond Elementary. It's a long distance. And so next year they're going to have breakfast and lunch at Tropico and at Rosamond Elementary School.
Well, that's good. Okay. I know that the Randy Scott, who represents the Antelope Valley Citizens for Responsible Use of Water, is away. He called me a couple days ago from Kentucky to tell me that. So there won't be anything. From Edwards Air Force Base. My day job is that I'm the chief of civic outreach for Edwards. I'm the guy that runs the tour program for the base. Somebody wants a guest speaker for something, I'm the guy you come to. If you want a flyover for something, I'm the first step for that. Yeah, when the moon is full, I'm the guy that gets those calls. I'll call you back on that later, Olaf. Wacko. So, the good news, as far as I'm concerned, is I have a summer hire. Because lately it's just been me. I'm a one-man band. Now, there are a lot of personalities in here, which kind of help if you only have one person. I'm kind of busy. So I actually have someone that actually can answer the phone and to help me out with it. And I'm pretty excited about that. For the last couple of years, the museum at the base has operated a restoration hangar up in ramps 11 and 12 near the F-22 area. The F-22s are getting ready to move down to where the F-16s were on the flight line. We're not sure who's going into those spaces at the north end of the flight line, but so somebody's coming in, but a contractor has to go in and refurbish those hangars for the next occupant, whoever that turns out to be. So they're moving the restoration hangar. They finally have a home for them up at North Base. So the work on restoring the aircraft they have on display is still there. People call me all the time and ask, is the museum open for visiting? And that's a trick question. The museum is, the base isn't. The only way currently you can visit the museum, unless you, if you don't have a pass to get you on and off normally, is you have to take a general public tour. Because of manning cuts and that kind of thing, I've had to go back to one general public tour a month. It's a very labor-intensive activity. It takes up a lot of my day every day to keep up with those rosters and the other tours. Consequently, there are no general public tour openings until February at this point. However, if you are interested in a tour of Edwards, you can either call me. My number is 277-3517. Or you can go on the Basis Public website, www.edwards.af, like for Air Force, .mil, like the first few letters of military. And when you're on the home page, look at the top, there's the word tours is up there in red letters. Select it, and it'll tell you when all the tours are. If you're interested in organizing a large group to come on base, I'm happy to have you. I'm limited to how many I can do in a month, but I do as many as possible. I've got a number of volunteer tour guides to help with that. It's just right up the street, you know, if you come on out and visit your tax man. Okay, enough requisite. And there is no open house and air show planned for here for next year. Instead, we're supporting the LA County Air Show at Foxfield in March. Any member of the public may address the council regarding any matter of concern to Rosamond residents. This need not be related to any items on the agenda. However, law prohibits the council from taking action on matters not on the agenda. Please limit your presentation to 3 minutes. We have a lot of folks. Okay.
Do you want a podium or what?
Do you want to step up to the podium to talk?
Yeah, we can move the podium to the middle. Or
no, I just had a quick question. Back to
you can stand.
Go ahead and stand.
I just had a quick question. I know we're not a city and we're not incorporated, but if we wanted to, would we be able to hold like a special election to add a tax or something to keep the sheriff's station open?
This is public commentary. We're not really, it's not an agenda. We're not allowed to.
We can take that question.
All right. Well, the short answer
is. Mr. Secretary, if you copy that question down, maybe we can.
I can give you a short answer to that. What is. No. The answer is, you can't do a special tax because we have no special district.
That's my question. I didn't know if there's anything.
Yeah. But you could either become a city or you could add, which is a long process, or you could add purposes and powers to have, like Bear Valley has the right to have a police department. And that way you could tax yourselves to have a police department. You could run it your own special district for the police department, or you could add it to the community services district, however you wanted to do that.
Okay.
A possibility to give some money to keep the police department here, or is this a political
I think that's a good question, right? Is there a way that the new biz money could cross over to keep them?
Those are some of the discussions that are going to be happening now over the next month, is to find out what money can be legally allocated to our defense and the government protection, because a lot of the money is grants from the state and federal government that have to be used for specific things, but there is money that like the Renewbiz program. It's a pretty new program, and we're trying to figure out if it can be used. Like you said,
that come from the solar panel.
The street lights that are going in on Diamond Street came. Those are from the solar and wind people. But the Diamond Street project was a federal grant. It's a transportation enhancement grant. Well, sure.
Okay. In the back.
Just a quick question. How many people do you have to have in the community before it's viable to try to become a city as opposed to just a town and control our own destiny?
The way the laws are written now with the vehicle funds not coming back to cities. The last city to incorporate was like 2007. Hacienda Heights in Los Angeles County is borderline at 60,000. That's my understanding of the way it says right now. If you're 60,000 people, you might be able to, and you might not, depending on what other factors you got going.
We don't have the revenue. We don't have the revenue.
You can't authority. Several years ago, we had somebody come in and speak. We had about this many people from the local agency formation commission, or LAFCO. And I got to tell you, there's nothing funny about LAFCO. The idea with this is they look at the formation of these various governmental bodies, And there has to be a tax base there. So at the time, the revenue sources just weren't there. But we can certainly look at that as a future program item. Does that sound like something that might be of interest to you?
Yes.
Okay. So we will look into a LAFCO presentation.
I can comment on this if you don't mind. Actually, okay, so originally I'm from a town of 4,500 people in Michigan. We were our own city with all of our tax money. Unfortunately, guys, the biggest problem with Rosamond is nobody wants to pay any extra money for anything. And if you want the revenue that Al's talking about, all our taxes have to go up. But what you don't understand is if our taxes go up, you're going to drive a lot of people that can't afford to be here out, which is a lot of the reason why we need the police department. So it's kind of you kind of got to say yes to some of these things that they're trying to pass. And of course, as we all know, they don't spend their money correctly as we want them to. But that's where it comes to play with our elections and who elect. So there is a process that can happen. It's not going to be bad. But I mean, Olaf, am I right? I mean, there are steps that we can take to try to make this work.
Yeah, there are other alternatives than becoming a city, yes, because as far as police enforcement goes, you have to go with county service areas or adding a purpose and power to the community service district or creating your own special district for police only or fire police only.
I guess my point of mentioning my hometown is our taxes were astronomical, but nobody cared paying them because there was only a certain amount of people that could afford to be in that town. It wasn't people that needed to steal anybody else's crap.
It only isn't it true that the state takes a lot of money away from the cities that used to go to the cities?
Vehicle license fees, yes.
They take a lot of money back to the state, so it makes it a lot. It's even harder now to become a city as it used to be, right?
Exactly. Like I said, when I looked at this issue 2 or 3 years ago, and 60,000 people is the in Hacienda Heights may or may not have the ability.
What was it the state took away from the cities?
Vehicle license
fees. Vehicle license. Yeah.
Okay, yes, sir.
So, there's an assessment for lighting district in West Park. Got that correct. Who controls who can set up an assessment? Can we in West Park set up an assessment to put up gates to privatize our streets?
No.
Again, I think you'd have to create your own service area if you wanted to buy the streets from the county and take them over.
When you say service area, could you maybe explain that to us?
Well, for example, we do have county services areas for maintaining 10 feet on United Street from Rosen Boulevard up to where it ends. That's a very small thing. That's one thing Coffin Broad tried. We have other service areas that cover more than that. But that's not the maybe the best way, but you can set up things that you're in charge of your own board rather than county be in charge of. There's a number of different avenues, but it all requires effort on your part to make it work.
Well, I'll give you effort for private security.
But like I said, that's a little more complicated, taking over the roads. I'm sure the county would mind giving you roads if you want to maintain them. That's one of the huge expenses they have.
Well, they're not maintaining them now, so even
well.
Those of you who have driven up and down 35th by the new developments with the bumps that were just installed, you're doing a great job.
Well, that's something you need.
Who do we go to for that? Is that
Mr. Rush is here. You can talk to me. We'll take care of the roads. That might be a better way to do it, a lot less complicated.
Okay, so we need to copy that question down and see, what about the second series here?
Well, taking care of the stuff on 35th might be the best.
Mr. McKay.
Yes, I have two questions for Sergeant Anton. Could he explain to the people what his patrol area is in square miles, and can he tell us what the boundaries of his patrol area are, so that the people can know that it's not just a 15 or 20 minute ride running code from the hop?
Our patrol area goes from approximately 110th Street West to the base, and from Avenue A to Bacchus. And on the west side of Bacchus, it goes up to the back of the attachment. So that's Rosamond's response area. Mojave's response area goes all the way basically to the county border with San Bernardino, more, east of Boron. So
is that?
40 miles.
So it takes 60, 70 to get from the far side all the way out here to Rosamond.
We have, they go all the way to Joplin Canyon.
Another question for you, where can I apply to my field carry permit?
The forms are online. Fill out the form and you can bring it out to the substation.
How many deputies are on staff in the lobby at this point? Are you guys fully manned? Or are you guys going to be coming out of Rosamond and finishing manning up on? So you're going to be short already out the gate.
We're short in both areas already to start with, so it's going to be combining whatever bodies that they take to load them in the lobby.
And how many short are we?
Right now, we have 10 deputies, we're slated for 13. So we're three down here. Well, Javi, I think, is down 4 or 5.
Do they delay you some more off?
According to the sheriff, yes.
They are going to lay more deputies off.
That's part of the budget process.
And do you feel 13 deputies is even the right amount for Rosamond?
Probably not.
Right, how many deputies were there when you were a deputy? How many years ago was that? 15, 16 years ago. So 15 years ago we had the same amount, and now.
Yeah. 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 The other side of the road is going to hell, and you can see it. When you drive it, not everybody's on that. But it is disgusting. You go through those apartments that look so nice. Maybe somebody
or 3 years ago? 4 years ago?
You know, those landlords or apartment owners would say, hey, you need to clean up your act, at least desert landscape, because it looks awful. And you can just see it flooding out, and it's coming across the tracks into the nicer neighborhoods. It's hard when you hear my neighbor come to work, and four of his cars got busted in one night. I don't want that coming into my neighborhood.
Okay. Yes, sir. In the dangled shirt.
Okay. Yeah, I got a question for the supervisors man there.
Ryan.
First of all, I want to thank the sergeant here for his efforts in doing everything he can to help us keep our community. And then I would like to state that if this is closed and we lose deputies, how far are they up that way? Back up that way. Well, there are going to be a ways that Mojave substation's not going to handle all our deputies. There's, you know, as far as them being able to work and do their job. Okay, you go south of here, about 25 miles, between here and that 25 miles is a quarter of a million people with a lot of goons. Whenever they find out that we're not really manned, yeah, what's going to happen? The cost of the rental of that building that we got here, is that money that we will no longer need to spend in the sheriff's department? I don't think so. I think that money is going to be spent in detectives and cars busting their butt over here from Bakersfield to invest the crimes that's going on.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right, who's up
next? And the cost of the vehicles.
Hold. Go ahead.
I have a question for Sergeant Anton. Based on the statistic you read off earlier, what is the crime rate in Rosamond doing? Because I think the perception in general is that it's on the rise quite significantly. It would be nice to know what the statistics say versus perception.
Well, the statistics can actually be deceiving because if you go back probably like since 2010, our calls for service probably stay within a couple hundred. Our highs are 1,100, our lows are about 900. So calls for service pretty much stay the same, but that's all depends on who calls. A lot of times people don't call us, they don't think it's worth calling us, they don't think we can do anything, the person's gone. So there are some stats that the sheriff gave at his at the board meeting Tuesday that might be interesting to you. Those are countywide stats, but not Rosamond. homicides for the county this year are up 100%.
Oh, wow.
Rapes are up 40.6%. Robberies are up 124%. Assault with deadly weapons up 20%. And car thefts are up 45%.
County what?
County what?
I know you're ready for the county, and the numbers are atrocious. But if Bakersfield went up 30%, which I know it probably went up more, that means we go up 120. So, you know, how much are we going up?
I don't have those stats. I would say that they're probably not as drastic as they are with another county. A lot of this has to do with factors that have nothing to do with the county. Prop 47 and KV 109 over the last couple of years has changed punishments for crimes, so that has nothing to do with county.
When you say county one, you're talking about the city of Bakersfield and all the cities. I think it hasn't gone up here because of your presence. Who knows what would happen if you're not here?
I understand, like, Prop 47. If I go in and shoplift at Eric's store and only get $500, all I'm going to get is a slap on the hand.
Except for Eric, he's going to punch you.
I'll turn it into his insurance.
Okay.
What is that? Is it $950, Jim? It's $950. Is there any theft? Your house could be stolen.
Houses are different. I don't even agree that it's on the three years because it's a great moment in someone's house.
Okay.
So we're going to get stolen, hike up the price.
Okay.
Is it my understanding that we are adding two more 250 unit tax credit units, apartments?
Yeah.
No, that's not true.
There's one 240 unit guy's trying to get it up off the ground, but it's not a tax, it's not a Section 8 tax.
It's not like the other two that are already in town.
We don't need any more.
Sir,
I think we all have the same concern as far as protection for our family, the protection for our community. I think we need to take a look, a step back, and just remember some comments that were made. Our sergeant over here, I appreciate your service, is that yes, the substation may be leaving, but the presence may be here, whether that presence is diminished or not. Issue being is with the reduced revenue, follow the money. You have a vote. Your vote counts. If the supervisor can't do the job that he needs to do, find a supervisor who can. If the sheriff cannot do the job that he needs to do, find a new sheriff that can. We need to be a community that Rosamond started out to be. Everybody is your neighbor. Everybody protects themselves, protects your neighbor. Remember that. That's how we started when it was Sandy Creek. Remember that. We haven't lost that. There were seven families who started Rosamond. They're still here. We're still here. So understand people being upset. People need to band together, communicate. There's only 115 here. Only 115. We have over 20,000 people in Rosamond, minimum. That was census back in 2010. So talk to your neighbors. Get the word out. Let them know. Take a look at your facts. Find out where your facts are. When you have meetings, show up. Thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it.
Volunteers, they are just eyes and ears. They do not
Okay. Down on reserves.
We have two reserves left.
Oh, really?
I do have a question.
How many do you have?
Four. When I first started, we probably had about 8 or 10.
What about protection for our children at school?
It'd be the same. I don't have a school deputy right now. It would be the same as it is right now, basically. They call when they need to see the family.
Nobody's on campus.
Not right now.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I have a lot to say about this town, especially this eye on Rosamond, okay? I am the 55-year-old that drives around in the white Mustang that everyone bashed, okay? My daughter was afraid to go home because someone mentioned where we lived, okay? That I was the one supposed to be telling everyone to back off, okay? Then my address was mentioned, okay? And then there was all these people that liked that I was hated on, okay? I think this town is a bunch of haters that need to grow up. I think this eye on Rosamond's a bunch of crap. And I think you guys all need to get a life that love people that are bashed on. I think it's terrible. And as far as the police department goes, I lived over in Whispering Hills Mobile Home Park, which was taken from me, stolen from me, by someone who sank my house. They ran water underneath my house. I have pictures of a pipe. Olaf, Landsgaard, don't look so confused, okay? I have pictures put away in a safe, which I don't want to use at this time in my life. It's like my daughter has to live here. Every time the police department would come out when I had things stolen from me, they'd ask me what kind of drugs I was on and if there was food in my refrigerator, okay? Never was one police report written for me when I had things stolen from me. There was never a police report written. And sir, I believe it was you that went to my friend's house after my internet it was knocked out for 3 weeks. I was yelling at the telephone company because I needed the internet for my daughter to do her homework. So I was yelling at the telephone company. So then indeed, four cops pulled me over and say, who are you yelling at? I was yelling at the phone company because I needed internet service for my daughter to do her homework. You went to my friend's house, Henry King, and told him I was a meth dealer and never to yet let him use his phone again. Okay? You personally went to my friend's house and told him to never let me use his phone again when I was trying to contact a lawyer to help me. Is that true, sir? Oh, that's not true?
Okay.
You're telling me that's not true. Can we just move on? No one is concerned about this in your town? No one is concerned about this.
Okay.
No one's concerned about that. No one can be concerned about the list I have of the police reports that where things were stolen from my house and not one report was written for me.
So do you want them gone? Do you want the cops gone?
Personally, they have never helped me. And then I go to my neighbor's house with a Bible in my hand to talk to a lady about something and four cops show up for me. I have someone enter my house and they don't show up for 2 hours. What is wrong with that picture? You tell me what is wrong with that picture.
Okay, ma'am.
They only hassle me. They did not help me. Move along with what you don't have to hear about.
Ma'am.
I'm upset.
We get that. Your 3 minutes are up.
Oh, I don't think so. I don't think that my clock has been 2 minutes.
Nope.
Okay, what is this Iron Roseman about?
Ma'am,
all it is
ma'am,
is a bunch of bashers.
Ma'am, your time is up.
My daughter's here to go home.
Ma'am, your time is up. Yeah. Thank you.
Well, it ain't a real world. It's a bunch of bashers and haters on Facebook.
Thank you. Ma'am, your time is up.
I don't use it.
Either you're welcome to zip the rest of the meeting or leave. Your choice.
This lovely little town. My daughter's scared to death to go home because of you bashers on Facebook.
Your time is up. Thank you.
Then it's orange shirt. Orange shirt
over
here on right.
Orange shirt.
Oh, yeah,
the orange shirt. Excuse me. Yeah,
that's
what you have
to get. I think as taxpayers, we should be entitled to a copy of the proposed budget before it becomes etched in stone by the county supervisor, because I'd like to kind of look at the cuts across the board and see what that...
The budget that was just
just which is a preliminary budget. That's what's going on right now. The final budget won't be approved until August. So this was preliminary.
Is the preliminary budget available online for people to look at?
I believe so. If not, I'll make sure.
I've got a copy in my hands. I don't know if anybody else does or not, but I'd like to look over the figures.
Sure.
And so we have a time to respond to, if you're doing this, like, you know, when you make a cut this gigantic, and the first thing you attack, this is my suspicion on the whole thing. The first thing you attack is critical services, fire, police protection, the DA's office for lack of ability to prosecute all the things that you want. And it really gets the attention, obviously, of the populace.
Well, one thing.
And so, excuse me, just a minute. I just want to make this point, and then I'll be done here. So, typically, I've lived on this planet long enough to watch little cities operate and so forth, and various levels of government. So the next thing to resolve this, folks, if you like, is we can raise your taxes. Well, I'm sorry. I want to make sure the cuts are universal across the board. We have so many damn giveaway programs, and I don't mind helping the people that need it. I'll be the first one to hand out to it. But I see too many. You know, look at the streets and loaf it all day long and visit our local 9 pot shops here in town. And I have nothing against medical marijuana if it really is working for the person. But I see a lot of people that are well gated and living along and don't seem to have a problem. Rest in their pajamas.
Okay, I'm fairly sure that the preliminary budget is on the county website.
Sure, it should be. And just so people can get kind of get their heads around the way the budget works, the big deficit is to the general fund. That's where the deficit is. Most of the county departments are not funded through the general fund. Only 3% of the entire county budget is discretionary. Only 3% the Board of Supervisors has control over where that goes. The general fund funds the fire department, the sheriff's department, probation, the DA, and I think the crime labs, the lab. So obviously if the general fund goes down, that's who will be affected because they are funded through the general fund. So
it's like the planning department self-sufficient?
The planning department, the roads department, every other department for the last 3 years have been making annual cuts to reduce their budgets. This year they're all making 5% cuts to their budgets. So everyone is making cuts, but yes, this budget will be available to the public to see. There will be budget hearings all through July, and the final budget will be accepted in August. So those are opportunities for the community to show up.
I'd like to see a copy before then, rather than...
It is available on the website.
Writing.
Well, it's available online on the county website.
If you Google Kern County preliminary budget, it'll come right up very first.
Yeah. There's also a really good website called USA.gov.
What I want people to know, too, when there's the Board of Supervisors meetings, I don't think a lot of people know this, you don't have to always drive all the way down to Bakersfield to see the meeting. For one, if you just want to watch, it's available on the county website. You can watch it live. If you want to comment, all you have to do is request on the county website to open up the Mojave Remote Testimony Station. They have a camera in there with the television set up. They will find out if there's anyone there who wants to speak. And you can speak directly to the Board of Supervisors during the meeting, and they can talk back to you. You can make your comments, you know, from that Mojave testimony station rather than having to drive all the way to Bakersfield. So that's one option if anyone's interested in participating in the meetings without having to drive all the way down.
The staffing will stay the same, and we'll lose the building. But are we still going to have, if the station closes, are we still going to have the basic deterrent value of deputies between calls, sitting at the fast trip parking lot, taking a break, sitting at the post office? Just, I like coming home late and seeing a couple of deputies' cars. Are we still going to have that without the station?
Staffing is going to probably change.
So will we still have deputies who are pretty much dedicated in Rosamond? I understand they go where they have to go for a call.
Okay, in the I'll give you just a second. In the back, right?
Yes, sir. In conjunction with the police station, I understand there's talk about shutting down some of the fire departments for lack of funding too. Is that true?
Well, the paper said it's going to spin off.
I think I'm not the Rosamond Fire Station. It's not is not proposed. I'm not sure which ones are proposed right now.
Well,
I don't think there's one in our district that is
proposed. The newspaper article I thought was talking about shutting down on some fire service out here.
Not on your roads. That hasn't been proposed or anything brought up.
As soon as you shut down fire stations, you can expect your insurance company.
Okay.
Right.
Ma'am?
I was just wondering, isn't there another sheriff station somewhere from Bakersfield? I mean, they have tons of them up there that they could give up so we could keep ours. I mean, that's a very large area, and I've been up there visiting, and they've got a lot of stations. We only have this one, and our community's growing. It's not shrinking, it's growing. They're building houses, they're building businesses, and we need to keep the sheriff station. I've only been here 22 years, and I don't want them to end up closing up and leaving, because they make me feel a lot safer being here. Just knowing they're here, whether I need them or not.
Exactly.
Thank you.
Hello.
I agree. Walk in.
Yeah, I've been here a little longer than 22 years. I was 8 years old when I came. I understand budgets. I question why every time there's a budget cut, it's on the east side of the mountain. I have a friend that spent quite a while in law enforcement for Kern County. He was a sergeant down here. And I picked his brain a little bit. And some suggestions, and this is addressed to Mr. Scribner's representative. Move all the, close the Mojave sub, per se. Yes, it's got the jail there, and keep the jail open, and it's got the courthouse. Rent. Courthouse is busy, they need more room anyway. Rent. To the judges and the courthouse for the extra income. That I paid for the rent on the Mojave, on the Rosamond sub. Move the Mojave deputies down here. It's a lot bigger area. Mm-hmm. If you're going to have to close the sub. The downside is response time to boron. Well, I'm sorry, guys. I'm more concerned about Rosamond than I am boron. Boron's got 8,000 people out there now. Like that. We talk about that 23,000 here. That's only from base binders to, I believe, 90th. And your actual response area, probably closer to 30,000. Possibly. What was the other thing we had? This is a tricky question. How many subs are they closing on the east side? I mean, on the west side.
I'm not aware.
Scribner needs to check into whether they're closing any in Wasco, Lamont, Delano.
It is Sheriff Youngblood's decision how he allocates his money. He chooses what substations to close, who, how many deputies to fire, where to fire them from. That is all his discretion.
I understand that, and I understand he got to come up with something. But supervisors need to look, all of them, all five of them, where can they at? I know the price of a barrel of oil is down, but it sure didn't go down at the pump.
Did they close boron, or did they open that back up?
Boron substation is closed. They have deputies out there.
It is closed. Yeah, I was
the
out there.
It's still there. It's still ours. But
I was out there, and people were signing up to patrol the street. The citizens.
They still have the same number of deputies and more on they had before the show. Is my understanding.
Yeah, zero. Two. They refined out of Mojave, correct?
Two full. Thank you.
My name is Russ Williams. I'm the deputy director for something in Tom Life. And he pretty much wanted to be here. He flew down from Sacramento, but it took a while to get there, so he wasn't able to make it. And he's very concerned about this. He spoke with Sheriff Youngblood today. who will assure him that this isn't in stone, that it's not, that the whole plan isn't in stone, but right now it's a possibility. And he wants to see anything he can possibly do to make sure, because he agrees entirely with what he does, to make sure this doesn't happen, that somehow we're able to continue the services here. As many of you know, he was raised in Boron. No one cares about Boron. He was raised in Boron, and he knows what it's like when the services are lost, when the station's closed. And those up there have assured him that there are still deputies on the streets, on the streets there, and they're still in the area. They said somehow it's not the same thing. It's not the same thing as having a station in your community. Because there's a lot to be said about that. So he called me a few hours ago and said, get up to Rosamond and see what we can find out from these people up here, see what we can do to help out. So just to let you know, contact our office, contact me.
And what's your number?
267-7636. Well, that's the wrong number then.
Okay. Thank you for coming. For the
groundbreaking. And I'll be there probably with them as well. But once again, this was, this is his home. This is a part of him. And when he heard about this, he got the earliest flight he could, and then things started messing up, and the traffic was the final thing on the 14th. Talked to him about an hour ago, and there was no way he was going to get up here in time. So that's when he told me to come see what's going on and help you guys out. So we're going to see what we can do. That's all I can say right now. You'll see what he can do to help out the supervisor's office and the sheriff's department and see what the
mentioned in 2010 there was 20,000 people that lived in Rosamond. How often do they do the census?
10 years.
10 years? Okay, so we're almost due. And what is the purpose of the event center? What is the Rosamond Event Center?
That's actually going to be an outdoor venue. It's not going to be an enclosed indoor venue. That's for putting on concerts, community plays, different events throughout the week.
Well, I'd rather have the police station.
Yeah, but it's separately funded.
Separate money?
No, that's chamber. That's a good point, and I kind of got that thought too, that once you get grants, we're going to invest money donation to building a Kern County Sheriff Station in Rosamond. Because
the renewed business money is being discussed as, I think, a possibility to see if that can be used for alternate needs like public needs.
And building a permanent structure for the community.
It's all being discussed right now. Everything. So it's all options around.
Thank
the
you.
Medical marijuana.
Can we tax them to play the sheriff's part? Yeah.
I mean, that's.
Out
here.
Nine of them? You don't have a base. Yeah.
You know,
I don't know what the process is.
Well, curiously, a couple of meetings ago, we had the Kern County Council, Teresa Golder here, as our speaker, talking about that exact thing. There was a wonderful story in the Antelope Valley Press, if you subscribe, and I would wholeheartedly encourage you to subscribe to every paper that's being printed. And if you don't, shame on you. How do you keep up if you don't? But there was a wonderful story in there that Allison Gallon did. It went into great detail about the hoops they've got to jump through to get them closed. They're just opening. They're not getting permission. They're just opening. So they're moving ahead with all due diligence. It's just frustrating to have so many. And it's an excellent point. Does anybody think we don't have enough medical marijuana?
Oh my God, there's
two. Yeah, see, we all remember again. So they are moving to do that. And you bring up an excellent point. I think we discussed that almost every meeting, don't we, Jim? Jim, don't we? There's not usually come up and we'll say,
well, have the supervisors take care of that. That's where that comes from.
Oh, I'm not sure if you guys remember. You guys remember several years ago we had a measure on the ballot, Measure G, that the voters passed in the county. You know, it was a landslide victory that the voters wanted, and it made it really difficult, almost impossible, to open up medical marijuana shops. And it gave our police, our sheriffs, power to do something about it. Okay. Well, the courts threw out Measure G just a few months ago. They threw it out. Said it doesn't matter, even though our voters in our county passed it. So the courts threw it out. Right now, the Kern County Board of Supervisors, in response to that, put out a moratorium banning all medical marijuana dispensaries that are in operation and banned any of them from opening. They're still opening. They're still going out and selling, trying to make money. Our only legal process to shut them down is to have a code compliance officer go out there, prove that there's marijuana, write them up, and then go through the whole entire legal process, which takes 90 days, 100, 180 days.
Which is their business license?
Yeah.
They don't have one.
They don't have a business license.
They don't pay taxes.
Basically, our efforts are being stymied by the courts.
And go to order, please. The other issue, I think, that comes from the state level, is that in November we're now expecting to vote in the state on the legalization of marijuana.
Yeah.
And so I think that might be why our measures, are getting kind of beat down. I think the state kind of wants to wait and see what happens there.
Why can't they give government money so that our town could be better if they're here?
Because it's illegal. At the federal government level, it's still illegal. Marijuana is illegal at the federal level. You can't tax something that is illegal.
They're not supposed to be within 1,000 feet of a school.
That's it.
And there's several, as you know, that are within 1,000 feet of Rosamond Elementary School. You might want to just keep on calling Mr. Lackey's office and telling him about those marijuana shops. Keep on reporting to Mr. Scribner's office through Ryan Rush about your disappointment with the various shops that are opening, in fact, especially the ones that are within 1,000 feet of Rosamond Elementary. Keep on making the complaints because they still need them.
Yep.
One of the problems, Ryan, how many code enforcement officers do we have throughout all of Kern County?
Oh, I don't know. In East Kern, I know we have a few. I don't know about the whole county.
I think we have a total of 6 the whole county. We're at 5 now, they're up to 6. So there are many. That process is really slow.
So, but the other thing is, our code enforcement officers, they can't, a lot of people don't know this, they can't go and initiate their own case. They can't drive around Rosamond, see problems, and write them up.
Somebody's getting money in this town.
The only way they can write up a code issue is if it comes from a complaint from the community. That's the only way they can do it legally due to property rights and private property issues. So our code compliance officers can't just drive around and write stuff up. You can call a code compliance officer. I'll give you all my number, my email, whatever you guys want.
You know,
what is your number?
Getting that number isn't that hard.
It's 661-868-3662.
Can you tell us about this measure that's going to be on the ballot in November?
I haven't seen the language. I don't know anything about it. All I know is supposedly they're going to have a measure on the ballot to legalize medical marijuana. Maybe our gentleman from Assemblyman Lackey's going to discuss this.
You know, Mr. Reyes?
Do you know the language for that bill they're talking about?
Legalized marijuana.
Well, keep watching for it. And it was
868-3662.
If you're concerned about the medical marijuana,
My email is rush@co.kern.ca.us.
What's that again? R, rush R?
Yep.
At co dot,
dot kern, K-E-R-N dot C-A dot U-S.
We can put that on our Facebook page.
Seriously, I'm probably a good person to talk to for any of your complaints. When it comes to the marijuana shops, if you want code compliance to know about it, if you have a road issue you want to complain about, anything like that, just give me a call or an email. Email might be faster response time because I get that straight on my device here.
Well, the thing is, like Zane has marijuana thing, and I want to thank the sergeant and his deputies for helping me out quite a bit. Me and my little community, which I represented 2 months ago, about 14 different families, they got rid of my marijuana thing that came out there. They just put it in there, dropped it in, and just started proceeding selling that stuff. They, like I said, they went out of clients, they got and had no running water out there. That porta potty's out there. They even put a portable windmill out there for electricity. And again, big thank you for myself and my community out there on the west side. Very much what you did, sir.
You know, my concern is shutting down the Kern County Sheriff's Office is the rise in the meth use that's going to come. The rise in the heroin that's going to come to town. The rise in the pills that's going to be used. There are many more meth houses here and dope houses than there are pot shops.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Really? Our children are dying off meth. You take the cops off the streets out of Rosamond, and you're going to have more meth users in this town. Sure of it. There's already a lot here, and I think that the pot shops right now are not our biggest concern, as it's going to be when they take the sheriffs out of Rosamond and the meth rate climbs. Because when the meth rate climbs, it's more robberies. It's more, you're going to get your cars broken into more. They all come out at night. And if you don't have that many nighttime officers on, then what kind of protection do we have? They're already doing it with officers in. You take them out, and I can guarantee you that right now, the addicts and the people who are out there causing the crimes, they are praying that this goes through. They are praying this goes through because then they can prey on us more. They can prey on our children more. Mm-hmm. And there are drug use at the schools. Take our school cops away. You know, I hear good things about them and I hear bad things about them. But there's going to be more drugs in our schools. One of us is going to lose another child or a loved one to the drugs. That's just my main concern.
Deputies are still going to be here, though.
Okay, does anybody? I usually don't say squat, but this requires a little bit. First off, you people can go take pictures of all these participants walking into these drug shops. And at that point, take some damn pictures all over town, and maybe your neighbors will stop hiring them and give them the $10 an hour that they want, or maybe you'll stop them from stealing a little bit and slow them down. Okay, just the sheer fact of an array of pictures out there. And second item, if you got a bitch with the sheriff, and my good man knows me personally, not that he likes me, but you go to the number one man in Bakersfield, take your information over there, point blank, and he will take care of it. I went over there. I had my next door neighbor was and still doing it as cockfights. I took the damn dead chicken over there and I gave it to him. He wouldn't take the chicken. I had to throw the trash can, no big deal. But he got the point. Okay. And my neighbor stole my dogs, not once, but twice. Nothing's ever came of that. I'm sorry, our sheriff's department is overwhelmed. And so it'd be bothered with dogs. Okay. But at any rate, you go to the number one man in Bakersfield, he will take care of what's over here. I know for a fact because our good sheriff here, he looks at me and he glares. That's okay. We're on equal ground. Okay.
I got something done because it had to be done. I made the trip. You guys make the trip.
I will. You'll let me
and
know
just that simple. And we go over there with facts. Don't go over there with
I got
he ain't got time for that crap. He needs facts.
He needs facts. Okay? I'd like to know that too.
Yes, sir. There are ways to communicate to our supervisor and to others how you feel.
Here? I mean, we're here tonight. We don't have. I mean,
well, his representative is here.
I'm glad that you're here. Why is Zach Stripner here? Why isn't Donny Youngblood here? And I would love to see Mr. Lackey here at the next meeting or something, so we kind of know what the hell's going on here.
Well, they're going to be at that event center Saturday morning at 9, so.
What's that?
They're
that's
gonna
not
be
a, tonight, though. I know that's going to be a dedication
well, that's
for
the time
new foundation.
To, okay, that's the time to tell him. You know? And we've got his number now. Absolutely. All right. If you had your say, then you had your say.